like to listen, sir.
Oh, well, I'm sorry for that, for your sake. I don't play accurately. Anyone can play accurately. I play with wonderful expression. As far as the piano is concerned, sentiment is my forte. I keep science for life.
Yes, sir.
And speaking of the science of life, have you got those cucumber sandwiches cut for Lady Bracknell?
Yes, sir.
Oh, by the way, Lane, I see from your books that on Thursday night, when Lord Shoreman and Mr. Worthing were dining here, 8 bottles of champagne are entered as having been consumed.
Yes, sir, 8 bottles and a pint.
Why is it that at a bachelor's establishment, the servants invariably drink the champagne? I ask merely for the information.
Well, I attribute it to the superior quality of the wine, sir. I've often observed that in married households, the champagne is rarely of a first-rate brand.
Good heavens! Is marriage so demoralising as that?
Oh, I believe it is a very pleasant state, sir. I haven't had much experience of it myself up to the present. I've only been married once, and that is in consequence of a misunderstanding between myself and a young person.
I don't think that I'm much interested in your family life, Lane.
No, sir. It's not a very interesting subject. I never think of it myself.
Very natural, I'm sure. That'll do, Lane. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Lane's views on marriage seem somewhat lax. Really, if the lower orders don't set us a good example, what on earth is the point of them? They seem to me, as a class, to have absolutely no moral responsibilities whatsoever.
Mr. Earnest Worthing.
How are you, Earnest? What brings you up to town?
Oh, pleasure, pleasure. Well, what else should bring one anywhere? Oh, eating as usual, I see, Algy.
I believe it is customary in good society to take slight refreshment at 5 o'clock. Where have you been since last Thursday?
Oh, the country.
Oh. And, what do you do down there?
Well, when one is in town, one amuses oneself. When one is in the country, one amuses other people. It is excessively boring.
And, who are these people you amuse?
Oh, neighbours, neighbours.
Oh. Got nice neighbours in your part of Shropshire?
Perfectly horrid. Never speak to one of them.
How immensely you must amuse them. Oh, by the way, Shropshire is your county, is it not?
Hey, Shropshire? Oh, yes, yes, of course. Hello. Why all these cups? Why cucumber sandwiches? Why such reckless extravagance in one so young? Who's coming to tea?
Merely Aunt Augusta and Gwendolen.
Ah, how perfectly delightful.
Yes, that is all very well and good, but I'm afraid she won't quite approve of your being here.
Well, may I ask why?
Oh, my dear fellow, the way you flirt with Gwendolen is perfectly disgraceful. It is almost as bad as the way Gwendolen flirts with you.
I am in love with Gwendolen. I came up to town expressly to propose to her.
I thought you said you'd come up for pleasure. I call that business.
How utterly unromantic you are.
There's nothing romantic in proposing. Why, it is perfectly romantic to be in love, but there is nothing romantic about a definite proposal. Why, one may be accepted, one usually is, I imagine, and then the excitement is over. The very essence of romance is uncertainty. If I ever get married, I shall certainly try and forget the fact.
Well, I have no doubt about that, dear Algy. The divorce court was specially invented for people whose memories are so curiously constituted.
Oh, there's no use speculating on the subject. Divorces are made in heaven. Please, don't touch the cucumber sandwiches. They were ordered specially for Aunt Augusta.
But you've been eating them all this time.
Well, that is a very different matter. She is my aunt. Here, have some bread and butter instead. The bread and butter is for Gwendolen. Gwendolen is devoted to bread and butter.
And very good bread and butter it is too.
Well, you need not eat it as if you were going to eat it all. You act as if you were married to her already. You're not married to her already, and I don't think you ever will be.
Well, why on earth would you say that?
Well, girls never marry the men they flirt with. Girls don't think it right.
Oh, that is nonsense.
It isn't. It is a great truth, and it accounts for the extraordinary number of bachelors that one sees all over the place. And in the second place, I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
Yes. Gwendolen is my first cousin. And before I consent to your marrying her, you'll have to clear up the whole question of Cecily.
Cecily? What do you mean? What on earth do you mean, Algy, by Cecily? I don't know anyone of the name of Cecily.
Bring me the cigarette case that Mr. Worthing left in the smoking room the last time he dined here.
Yes, sir.
You mean to say you've had my cigarette case all this time? Well, I wish to goodness you would have let me know. I have been writing frantic letters to Scotland Yard about it. I was very nearly offering a large reward.
Well, I wish you would offer one. I happen to be more than usually hard up.
Well, there is no use offering a large reward now that the thing is found.
I think that is very mean of you, Ernest, I must say. However, it makes no difference, for now that I look at the inscription inside, I see that the thing isn't yours after all.
Of course it's mine. You've seen me with it 100 times, and you have no right whatsoever to read what is written inside. It is a very ungentlemanly thing to do, to read a private cigarette case.
Oh, it is absurd to have a hard and fast rule about what one should read and what one shouldn't. Half of modern culture depends on what one shouldn't read.
I'm quite aware of the fact, but I don't propose to discuss modern culture. It isn't the sort of thing one should talk of in public. I simply want my cigarette case back.
Yes, but this isn't your cigarette case. This cigarette case is a present from someone of the name Cecily, and you said you don't know anyone of that name.
Well, if you really want to know, Cecily happens to be my aunt.
Your aunt?
Yes, jolly old lady she is too. Lives in Tunbridge Wells. Just give it back, Algy.
Yes, but why does your aunt call you her uncle? From little Cecily, with her fondest love, to her dear Uncle Jack.
Well, my name is Ernest in town, and Jack in the country. And the cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but that still doesn't account for the fact that your small aunt Cecily calls you her uncle. Come on, old boy, you'd much better have the thing out at once.
My dear fellow, you talk exactly as if you were a dentist. It is very vulgar to talk like a dentist when one isn't one. It produces a false impression.
But that is exactly what dentists always do. Now, go on. I may admit that I have always suspected you of being a confirmed and secret Bunburyist, and now I am quite sure of it.
Bunburyist? What on earth do you mean by a Bunburyist?
I'll reveal to you the meaning of that incomparable phrase just as soon as you're kind enough to explain to me why you are Ernest in town and Jack in the country.
Well, produce my cigarette case first.
Here you are. Now, produce your explanation and pray make it improbable.
My dear fellow, there is nothing improbable about my explanation at all. In fact, it is perfectly ordinary. Yeah. Old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a little boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew. Cecily, who refers to me as her uncle, from motives of respect you couldn't possibly appreciate, lives at my place in the country under the charge of her admirable governess, Miss Prism.
And where is that place in the country, by the way?
That isn't for you to know, dear boy. You're not going to be invited. In fact, I may candidly tell you that the place is not in Shropshire.
Oh, I suspected that, my dear fellow. I have bunburyed all over Shropshire on 2 separate occasions. Now, go on. Why are you Ernest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear fellow, I don't know whether you'll be able to understand my real motives. You're hardly serious enough. When one is placed in the position of guardian, one must adopt a high moral tone on all subjects. It is one's duty to do so. And as a high moral tone can hardly be said to conduce very much to either one's health or one's happiness, in order to get out to town, I have always pretended that I have a younger brother, by the name of Ernest, who lives in the Albany, and gets into the most dreadful of scrapes. That, my dear Algy, is the truth, pure and simple.
The truth is never pure and rarely simple. Modern life would be very tedious if it were either. And modern literature a complete impossibility.
And that wouldn't be at all a bad thing.
Literary criticism is not your forte, my dear fellow. Don't try it. You should really leave that to people who haven't been to university. They do it so well in the daily papers. What you really are is a Bunburyist. Yes, I was quite right in saying you're a Bunburyist. In fact, you are one of the most advanced Bunburyists I know.
What on earth do you mean?
You have invented a very useful younger brother called Ernest, so that you may be able to come up to the town as often as you like. I have invented a perfectly invaluable invalid called Bunbury, so that I may be able to go down to the country whenever I choose. Yes, Bunbury is perfectly invaluable. In fact, if it wasn't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, for instance, I wouldn't be able to dine with you at Willis's tonight, for I've been really engaged to Aunt Augusta for more than a week.
I haven't asked you to dine with me anywhere tonight.
I know, you are absurdly careless about sending out invitations. Nothing annoys people more so much as not receiving invitations.
You'd much better dine with your Aunt Augusta.
I haven't the slightest intention of doing anything of the kind. To begin with, I dined there on Monday, and once a week is quite enough to dine with one's own relations. In the second place, whenever I do dine there, I'm always treated like a member of the family, and either sent down with no women at all, or two. In the third place, I know perfectly well who she'll place me next to tonight. She'll place me next to Mary Farquhar, who always flirts with her husband across the dinner table. It's not pleasant. Indeed, it's not even decent. And that sort of thing is enormously on the increase. The amount of women in London who flirt with their own husbands is perfectly scandalous. It's so bad. It's simply washing one's own clean linen in public. Besides, now that I know that you are to be a confirmed Bunburyist, I naturally want to talk to you about Bunbury. I want to tell you the rules.
I'm not a Bunburyist at all. If Gwendolen accepts me, I'm going to kill my brother. Indeed, I think I would kill him in any case. Cecily has become a little too much attached to him. It is rather a bore. Therefore, I'm going to get rid of Earnest, and I strongly advise you to do the same with Mr... with your invalid friend with the absurd name.
Nothing will induce me to part with Bunbury, and if you ever get married, which to me seems extremely problematic, you'll be very glad to know Bunbury. A man who marries without knowing Bunbury has a very tedious time of it.
Oh, that is nonsense. If I marry a charming girl like Gwendolen, and she is the only girl I ever saw in my life that I would marry, I certainly won't want to know Bunbury.
Then your wife will. What you don't seem to realise, my dear fellow, is in married life, three is company, and two is none.
That, my dear young friend, is the theory that the corrupt French drama has been propounding for the last 50 years.
Yes, and that the happy English home has proved it more than half the time.
But for heaven's sake, don't try to be cynical. It is perfectly easy to be cynical.
It's not easy to be anything nowadays. There's such a lot of beastly competition about it. That'll be Aunt Augusta and Gwendolen. Only relatives or creditors ever ring in the Wagnerian manner. Now, if I get her out of the way for 10 minutes to give you an opportunity for proposing to Gwendolen, may I please dine with you at Willis's tonight?
I suppose so, if you must.
Yes, but you must be serious about it. I hate people who aren't serious about meals. It's so shallow of them.
Lady Bracknell and Miss Fairfax.
Good afternoon, dear Algernon. I trust you are behaving very well.
I'm feeling very well, Aunt Augusta.
That's not quite the same thing. In fact, the two things rarely go together.
Dear me, you are smart.
I am always smart. Am I not, Mr. Worthing?
You are quite perfect, Miss Fairfax.
Oh, I hope I'm not that. That would leave no room for developments. And I intend to develop in many directions.
I'm sorry for a little late, Algernon. But I was obliged to call on dear Lady Harbury. I haven't been there since her poor husband's death. I never saw a woman quite so altered. She looks quite 20 years younger.
Can I interest you in a cup of
tea? Yes, well, I will have a cup of tea and one of those nice cucumber sandwiches you promised me.
Certainly, Aunt Augusta.
Won't you come and sit over here, Gwendolen?
Thanks, Mama. I'm quite comfortable where I am.
Lane! Why are there no cucumber sandwiches? I ordered them specially.
There were no cucumbers in the market this morning, sir. I went down twice.
No cucumbers?
No, sir. Not even for ready money.
Lane, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I'm greatly distressed about this, Aunt Augusta. About there being no cucumbers and not even for ready money.
Oh, really, next dear Matter, Algernon. I had some crumpets with Lady Harbury, who seems to be living entirely for pleasure now.
I hear her hair's turned quite golden from grief.
It certainly has changed its colour. From what cause, I of course cannot say. Thank. I have a real treat for you tonight, Algernon. I'm going to send you down with Mary Farquhar. She's such a nice woman, and so attentive to her husband, it's delightful to watch them.
I'm afraid, Aunt Augusta, that I'll have to give up the opportunity of dining with you tonight after all.
I hope not, Algernon. It would put my table completely out. Your uncle would have to dine upstairs. Fortunately, he is accustomed to that.
It's a great bore, and I need hardly say a terrible disappointment, but the fact is, I've just received a telegram informing me that my poor invalid friend Bunbury is very ill again. They seem to think I should be with him.
It is very strange. This Mr. Bunbury seems to suffer from curiously bad health.
Oh, yes. Bunbury is a dreadful invalid.
Well, I must say, Algernon, I think it is high time that Mr. Bunbury made up his mind whether he was going to live or die. This shilly-shallying with the question is absurd. Nor do I in any way approve of this modern sympathy with invalids. I consider it morbid. Illness of any kind is hardly a thing to be encouraged in others. Health is the primary duty of life. I'm always telling that to your poor uncle, but he never seems to take much notice as far as any improvement in his ailment goes. But I would be much obliged if you would tell Mr. Bunbury from me to be kind enough not to have a relax this Saturday, for I rely on you to arrange my music for me. It's my last reception of the season, and one wants something that will encourage conversation, particularly at the end of the season, when most people have practically said everything they have to say, which in most cases was probably not much.
I'll speak to Bunbury, Aunt Augusta, if he's still conscious, of course. And I think I can promise you, he'll be all right by Saturday. But of course, the music is a great difficulty. You see, if one plays good music, people don't listen. And if one plays bad music, people don't talk. But I'll run over the programme I've drawn out, if you'll kindly come with me into the next room for a moment.
I'm sure the programme will be delightful, Algernon, after a few expurgations. Now, French songs I cannot possibly allow. People always seem to think they are improper, and either laugh, which is vulgar, or look shocked, which is worse. But German sounds a thoroughly respectable language, and indeed I believe 'tis so.
Yes.
You will accompany me, Gwendolen.
Yes, Mama.
Charming day it has been, Miss Fairfax.
Pray don't talk to me about the weather, Mr. Worthing. Whenever people talk to me about the weather, I always feel quite certain that they mean something else, and that makes me so nervous.
I do, in fact, mean something else.
I thought so. In fact, I'm never wrong.
And I would also like to be allowed to take advantage of Lady Bracknell's temporary...
I would certainly advise you to do so. Mama has a way of coming back suddenly into a room I've often have to speak to her about.
Miss Fairfax. Gwendolen. Ever since I met you, I've admired you more than any girl I've ever met since... I met you.
Yes. I'm quite well aware of the fact. And I often wish that in public, at any rate, you'd been more demonstrative. To me, you have always had an irresistible fascination. Even before I met you, I was far from indifferent to you. We live, as I hope you know, Mr. Worthing, in an age of ideals. The facts are constantly mentioned in the more expensive monthly magazines, and I've reached the provincial pulpits, I am told. And my ideal has always been to love someone with the name Earnest. There is something in that name that inspires absolute confidence. From the moment Algernon first mentioned to me he had a friend named Earnest, I knew I was destined to love you.
And you really love me, Gwendolen?
Passionately.
Darling, you don't know how happy you've made me.
My own Earnest.
Yes. Of course, you don't need to say that you couldn't love me if my name wasn't Earnest.
But your name is Earnest.
Yes, yes, I know it is, but just supposing it was something else. Do you mean to say you couldn't love me then?
That is clearly a metaphysical speculation, and like most metaphysical speculations, has very little reference at all to the actual facts of real life as we know them.
Well, personally, darling, but speak quite candidly, I don't much care for the name of Earnest. I don't think it suits me at all.
It suits you perfectly. It is a divine name. It has music of its own. It produces vibrations.
Well, really, Gwendolen, I must say I think there are lots of other much nicer names. Jack, for instance. A charming name.
Jack? No. No, there is very little music in the name Jack, if any at all. Indeed, it does not thrill. It produces absolutely no vibrations. No, I have known several Jacks, and they all, without exception, were more than usually plain. Besides, Jack's a notorious domesticity for John, and I pity any woman who is married to a man named John. She may never be allowed to know the entrancing pleasure of or a single moment's solitude. No, the only real safe name is Earnest.
Well, Gwendolen, I must get christened. Oh, we must get married at once. There's no time to be lost.
Married, Mr. Worthing?
Well, surely. You know that I love you, and, well, you led me to believe, Miss Fairfax, that you weren't absolutely indifferent to me.
I adore you. But you haven't proposed to me yet. The subject's not even been touched on.
Well, can I propose to you now?
I think it would be an admirable opportunity. And to save you any possible disappointment, I think it only fair to tell you, quite frankly beforehand, that I am fully determined to accept you.
Gwendolen!
Yes, Mr. Worthing? What have you got to say to me?
You know what I've got to say to you.
Yes, but you don't say it.
Gwendolen, will you marry me?
Of course I will, darling. How long you've been about it. I'm afraid you have very little practice in how to propose.
My own one. I've never loved anyone else in the world but you.
Yes, but men often propose to practice. I know my brother Gerald does. All my girlfriends tell me so. Wonderfully brown eyes you have, Ernest. They are deep. Deep brown. I hope you will always look at me just like this. Especially when other people are present.
Mr. Irving! Rise, sir, from this semi-recumbent posture. It is most indecorous.
Mama, I must beg you to retire. This is no place for you. Besides, Mr. Irving has not quite finished yet.
Finished what, may I ask?
I'm engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing, Mama.
Pardon me, you are not engaged to be married to anyone. When you do become engaged, I or your father, should his health permit him, will inform you of the fact. An engagement should come upon a young girl as a surprise. Pleasant or unpleasant as the case may be, it is hardly a matter she could be allowed to arrange for herself. And now I have a few questions to put to you, Mr. Worthing. While I do so, you, Gwendolen, will wait for me below in the carriage.
Mama.
In the carriage, Gwendolen. Gwendolen! The carriage!
Yes, Mama.
You may take a seat, Mr. Worthing.
Thank you, Lady Bracknell. I prefer standing.
I feel bound to tell you that you are not down on my list of eligible young men. Although I have the same list the dear Duchess of Bolton has, we work together, in fact. However, I am quite prepared to enter your name should your answers be what a really affectionate mother requires. Do you smoke?
Yes, I must admit that I smoke.
I am glad to hear it. A man should always have an occupation of some kind. There are far too many idle men in young London as it is. What is your age?
29.
An excellent age to be married at. I have always been of opinion that a man who desires to get married should know either everything or nothing. Which do you know?
I know nothing, Lady Bracknell.
I am pleased to hear it. I do not approve of anything that tampers with natural ignorance. Ignorance is like a delicate exotic fruit. Touch it, and the bloom is gone. The whole theory of modern education is radically unsound. Fortunately, in England, at any rate, education produces no effect whatsoever. If it did, it would prove a serious threat to the upper classes and probably lead to acts of violence in Grosvenor Square. What is your income?
Between 7,000 and 8,000 a year.
In land or in investments?
In investments, chiefly.
That is satisfactory. What between the duties expected of one during one's lifetime and the duties exacted from one after one's death, land has ceased to be either a profit or a pleasure. It gives one position and prevents one from keeping it up. That is all that can be said about land.
Well, I have a house in the country with some land, of course, attached to it. About 1,500 acres, I believe. Of course, I don't depend on that for my real source of income. No, as far as I can make out, the poachers are the only people who make anything of it.
A country house? How many bedrooms? Well, that matter can be cleared up afterwards. You have a townhouse, I hope. A girl with a simple, unspoiled nature like Gwendolen could hardly be expected to reside in the country.
Well, I have a house in Belgrave Square, but it is let by the year to Lady Bloxham. Of course, I can get it back whenever I like, at 6 months' notice.
Lady Bloxham? I don't know her.
Well, she goes about very little these days. She is a lady considerably advanced in years.
Oh, nowadays that is no guarantee of respectability of character. What number, Belgrave Square?
149.
Oh, the unfashionable sign. I thought there was something. However, that can easily be altered.
The fashion or the sign?
Both, if necessary, I presume. What are your politics?
I'm afraid I have none, Lady Bracknell. I mean, I'm a liberal. Unionist?
Oh. Oh, they count as Tories. They dine with us, or come in the evening at any rate. Good. Now to minor matters. Are your parents living?
I have lost both my parents.
To lose one parent, Mr. Worthing, may be considered a misfortune. To lose both looks like carelessness. Who was your father? He was evidently a man of some wealth. Was he born in, with what the radical papers call the purple of commerce? Or did he rise from the ranks of the aristocracy?
I'm afraid I really don't know. The fact is, Lady Bracknell, I said I have lost my parents. It would be closer to the truth to say that my parents seem to have lost me. I don't actually know who I am by birth. I was found.
Found?
The late Mr. Thomas Cardew, an elderly gentleman of a very charitable and kindly disposition, found me and gave me the name of Worthing. Because he happened to have a first-class ticket to Worthing in his pocket at the time. Worthing is a place in Sussex. It is a seaside resort.
And where did the charitable gentleman who had a first-class ticket for this seaside resort find you?
In a handbag.
A handbag?
Yes, Lady Bracknell, I was in a handbag. A somewhat large handbag with a pair of handles to it. An ordinary handbag, in fact.
And in what locality did this Mr. James or Thomas Cardew come across this ordinary handbag?
In the cloakroom at Victoria Station. It was given to him in mistake for his own.
The cloakroom at Victoria Station?
Yes. The Brighton line.
The line is immaterial. Mr. Worthing, I confess to feel somewhat bewildered by what you have just told me. To be born, or at any rate bred in a handbag, whether it had handles or not, seems to me to display a contempt for the ordinary decencies of family life, and remind one of the worst excesses of the French Revolution. And I presume you know what that unfortunate movement led to. As for the particular locality in which the handbag was found, the cloakroom of a railway station might serve to conceal a social indiscretion, has indeed probably been used for that purpose before now. But it could be hardly regarded as an assured basis for a recognized position in good society.
Well, may I ask what you would advise me to do then? I need hardly say I would do anything in the world to ensure Gwendolen's happiness.
I would strongly advise you, Mr. Worthing, to try and acquire some relations as soon as possible, and to make a very definite effort to produce at least one parent of either sex before the season is quite over.
I don't see how I could possibly manage to do that. I can produce the handbag at any moment. It's in my dressing room at home. I really think that should satisfy you, Lady Bracknell.
Me, sir? What has it to do with me? You could hardly expect that I and Lord Bracknell would allow our only daughter, a girl brought up with the utmost care, to form an alliance with a cloakroom and marry into a parcel? Good morning, Mr. Worthing.
Good morning.
For heaven's sake, Algy, stop playing that ghastly tune! How idiotic you
you are.
Did it go off all right then, old boy? You don't mean to say she refused you. I know, it's a way she has. She's always refusing people. I think it is most ill-natured of her.
Gwendolen is as right as a trivet. As far as she is concerned, we are engaged. Her mother, perfectly unbearable. I've never met such a gorgon. I don't really know what a gorgon is like, but... And I'm quite sure Lady Bracknell is one. In any case, she is a monster without being a myth, which is rather unfair. Oh, I do beg your pardon, Algy. I suppose I shouldn't talk about your own aunt in that way before you.
My dear boy. I love hearing my relations abused. It's the only thing that makes me put up with them at all. Relations are simply a tedious pack of people who haven't the remotest knowledge about how to live, nor the smallest instinct about when to die.
Oh, that is nonsense!
It isn't!
Well, I won't argue with you about the matter. You always want to argue about things.
Well, that is exactly what things were originally made for.
Upon my word, if I thought that, I would shoot myself! You don't think there's any possibility of Gwendolen becoming like her mother in about 150 years, do you?
All women become like their mothers. It's their tragedy. No man does. That is his.
Is that clever?
It's perfectly phrased. And quite as true as any observation in civilised life should be.
Well, I'm quite sick to death of cleverness. Everybody's clever nowadays. You can't go anywhere without meeting clever people. The thing has become an absolute public nuisance. I wish to goodness we had a few fools left.
We have.
Oh? Well, I would extremely like to meet them. What do they talk about?
The fools? Oh, of the clever people, of course.
Oh, a fool.
Did you, get around to telling Gwendolen about your being Earnest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear fellow, the truth isn't quite the sort of thing one tells to a nice, sweet, refined girl. What extraordinary ideas you have about the way to behave to a woman.
The only way to behave to a woman is to make love to her if she is pretty, and to someone else if she is plain.
Oh, that is nonsense!
What about your brother? What about the profligate Earnest?
Well, by the end of the week, I shall have got rid of him. I shall say he died in Paris of apoplexy. Lots of people die of apoplexy quite suddenly, don't they?
Yes, but it's hereditary, my dear fellow. It's the sort of thing that runs in families. You'd much rather say severe chill.
And you're quite sure severe chill isn't hereditary, or anything of the kind?
Of course it isn't!
Very well, then. My poor brother Earnest, carried off quite suddenly in Paris by a severe chill. That gets rid of it.
But I thought you said this Miss Cardew was a little too attached to your brother. Oh. Won't she feel his loss a great deal?
That is quite all right. Cecily's not a silly romantic girl, I'm quite glad to say. She has got a capital appetite, goes on long walks, and pays no attention whatsoever in her lessons.
Huh. I would really rather like to meet Cecily.
I'll take very good care you never do. She is excessively pretty, and only just 18.
Ooh! Have you told Gwendolen you have an excessively pretty ward who is only just 18?
Well, one doesn't blurt these things out to people. Cecily and Gwendolen are perfectly certain to become extremely great friends. I bet you anything you like, half an hour after they have met, they will be calling each other sister.
Women only call each other that after they've called each other a lot of other things first. Now, my dear boy, we really must go and change if we want to get a good table at Willis's tonight. Did you know it's nearly 7?
Oh, it is always nearly 7.
Well, I'm hungry.
I never knew you when you weren't.
What shall we do after dinner? Shall we go to the club?
Oh, no, I hate talking.
Oh. Well, why don't we go to the theatre then?
Oh, no, I love listening.
Well, we might walk around the Empire at 10.
Oh, no, I can't bear looking at things. It's so silly.
Well, what shall we do?
Nothing.
Well, it's awfully hard work doing nothing. Then again, I don't mind a bit of hard work when there's no definite object of any kind.
Miss Fairfax.
Gwendolen, upon my word!
Algy, kindly turn your back. I have something very particular to say to Mr. Worthing.
Really, Gwendolen, I don't think...
You always adopt a strictly immoral attitude towards life. You are not quite old enough to do so.
My own darling.
Earnest. We may never be married. I fear from the expression on Mama's face we never shall. Few parents nowadays pay any regard to what their children say to them. The old-fashioned respect for the young is fast dying out. Any influence that I had over Mama, I lost at the age of 3. But although she may prevent us from becoming man and wife, and I may marry someone else, and marry often, nothing she can possibly do can alter my eternal devotion to you.
Oh, Gwendolen.
The story of your romantic origin, as related to me by Mama with pleasing comments, has naturally stirred the deeper fibres of my nature. Your Christian name has an irresistible fascination. The simplicity of your character makes you exquisitely incomprehensible to me. Your town address at the Albany I have. What is your address in the country?
The Manor House, Walton, Hertfordshire.
There is a good postal service, I suppose. It may be necessary to do something desperate. That, of course, will take serious consideration. I shall communicate with you daily.
My own one.
How long do you remain in town?
Till Monday.
Good. Algie, you may turn around now.
Thanks, I've turned around already.
You may also ring the bell.
You will let me see you to your carriage, won't you, darling?
Certainly.
I will see Miss Fairfax out.
Yes, sir.
A glass of sherry, Lane.
Yes, sir.
Tomorrow, Lane, I am going fun-breeing.
Yes, sir.
I shan't be back until Monday. You can put out all my dress clothes, the smoking jacket and the Bunbury suits.
Yes, sir.
I hope tomorrow will be a fine day, Lane.
It never is, sir.
You're a perfect pessimist, Lane.
Oh, I do my best to give satisfaction, sir.
Oh, there's a sensible intellectual girl. The only girl I ever cared for in my life. What are you so amused at?
I'm just a little worried about Bunbury, is all.
If you don't take care, your friend Bunbury will get you into a serious scrape someday.
But I love scrapes. They're the only things that are never serious.
Oh, that is nonsense, Algie. You never talk anything but nonsense.
Well, nobody ever does.
Cecily, surely such a utilitarian occupation as the watering of flowers is rather Malton's duty than yours, especially at a moment when intellectual pleasures await you. Your German grammar is on the table. Pray open it at page 15 and we will repeat yesterday's lesson.
But I don't like German. It isn't at all becoming language. I know perfectly well that I look quite plain after my German accent.
Child, you know how anxious your guardian is that you should improve yourself in every way. He laid particular stress on your German when he was leaving the town yesterday. Indeed, he always lays stress on your German when he's leaving for town.
Dear Uncle Jack is so very serious. Sometimes I think he is so serious that he cannot be quite well.
Oh, your guardian enjoys the best of health. And his gravity of demeanour is especially to be commended in one so comparatively young as he is. I know no one who has a higher sense of duty and responsibility.
I suppose that is why he often looks a little bored when we three are together.
Oh, child. Mr. Worthing has a great many troubles in his life. Idle merriment and triviality would be quite out of place in this conversation. You must remember his constant anxiety over that unfortunate young man, his brother.
I wish Uncle Jack would allow that unfortunate young man, his brother, to come down here sometimes. He might have a good influence over him.
I am sure you certainly would.
You know German and geology and, well, things of that kind influence a man very much.
I'm not sure that even I could produce any effect on a character that, according to his own brother, sure that I would wish to reclaim him. I'm not in favour of this modern mania for making bad people into good people at a moment's notice. As a man sows, so let him reap. Oh, Cecily, you must put away your diary. I really don't know why you keep a diary at all.
I keep a diary in order to enter the wonderful secrets of my life. If I didn't write them down, I should probably forget all about them.
Memory, my dear Cecily, is the diary that we all carry about with us.
Yes, but usually it chronicles things that have never happened and couldn't possibly have happened. I believe that memory is responsible for nearly all the three-volume novels that Moody sends us.
Do not speak slightingly of the three-volume novel, Cecily. I wrote one myself in earlier days.
Did you really, Miss Prism? How wonderfully clever you are. Well, I hope it did not end happily. I don't like novels that end happily. They depress me so much.
Well, the good ended happily and the bad unhappily. That is what fiction means.
Well, yes, I suppose so, but it seems very unfair. And was your novel ever published?
Alas, no. The manuscript was abandoned.
Abandoned?
Then I use the word in the sense of lost or mislaid. Oh, to your work, child. These speculations are profitless.
But I see dear Dr. Chasuble coming up through the garden.
Dr. Chasuble, this is indeed a pleasure.
How are we, the Swanee? Miss Prism, you are, I trust, well.
Miss Prism has just been complaining of a slight headache. But I think it would do her so much good to have a short stroll in the park with you, Dr. Chasuble.
Cecily, I never mentioned anything about a headache.
No, dear Miss Prism, I know that. But I felt instinctively that you had a headache. Indeed, I was thinking about that and not about my German lesson when the rector came in.
I hope, Cecily, that you are not attentive.
Oh, I'm afraid I am.
That is strange. Were I fortunate enough to be Miss Prism's pupil, I would hang upon her lips. I spoke metaphorically. My metaphor was taken from bees. Mr. Worthing, I suppose, has not yet returned from town.
No, we do not expect him till Monday afternoon.
Yes, he usually likes to spend his Sunday in London. He is not one of those whose sole aim in life is enjoyment. That's by all accounts that unfortunate young man his brother seems to be. But I must not disturb Egeria and her pupil any longer.
Egeria? My name's Letitia, Doctor.
Ah, a mere classical illusion taken from the pagan authors. I trust I will see you both in Evensong.
I think that perhaps I will take a stroll with you, dear Doctor. I find I have a headache after all, and a walk might do it good.
With pleasure, Miss Prism, with pleasure. And we might even go as far as the schools and back.
Oh, that would be delightful. Cecily, you will read your political economy in my absence. The chapter on the fall of the rupee you may omit. It is somewhat too sensational. Even these metallic problems have their melodramatic side.
Horrid political economy, horrid geography, horrid German.
Mr. Ernest Worthing has just driven over from the station with his luggage.
Mr. Ernest Worthing, before the Albany West. Uncle Jack's brother.
Oh,
did you tell him Mr. Worthing was in town?
Oh, he was very disappointed. I told him that you and Miss Prism were in the garden. He was very anxious to speak to you privately.
Pray, ask Mr. Worthing to come here, and I suppose you better arrange a room for him.
Yes, miss.
I have never met any really wicked person.
rather frightened. I am so afraid he will look just like everyone else.
He does.
You are my little cousin Cecily, I'm sure.
You are under some strange mistake. I am not little. In fact, I believe I'm more than usually tall for my age. But I am your cousin Cecily. You, I take from your card, are Uncle Jack's brother. My cousin Earnest, my wicked cousin Earnest.
Oh, I'm not really wicked, cousin Cecily. You mustn't think that I am wicked.
If you are not, then you have certainly been deceiving us all in a very inexcusable manner. I hope you have not been leading a double life, pretending to be wicked but really being good all the time. That would be hypocrisy.
Well, of course I have been reckless.
I am glad to hear it.
In fact, now that you mention it, I have been very bad. In my own small way.
I don't think you should be so proud of that, though I'm sure it must have been very pleasant.
It is much pleasanter being here with you.
I can't understand how you were here at all. Uncle Jack won't be back until Monday afternoon.
Oh, that is a great disappointment. I'm obliged to go up by the first train on Monday morning. I have a business appointment that I am anxious to miss.
Couldn't you miss it anywhere but in London?
No, the appointment is in London.
Oh, well, I know, of course, how important it is not to keep a business engagement if one wants to retain any sense of the beauty in life. But still, I think you had better wait until Uncle Jack arrives. I know he is anxious to speak to you about your emigrating.
About my what?
Your emigrating? He has gone to buy your outfit.
I certainly wouldn't let Jack buy my outfit. He has no taste in neckties whatsoever.
Well, I don't think you will require neckties. Uncle Jack is sending you to Australia.
Australia? But Sue and I?
Well, he said at dinner on Wednesday evening that you would have to choose between this world, the next world, and Australia.
Oh. Well, the accounts that I've received of Australia and the next world aren't particularly encouraging. This world is good enough for me, Cousin Cecily.
Yes, but are you good enough for it?
I'm afraid I am not that. That is why I was hoping you might reform me. You might make that your mission, Cousin Cecily.
I'm afraid I have no time this afternoon.
Oh, well, would you mind my reforming myself this afternoon?
It is rather quixotic of you, but I think you should try.
Thank you. In fact, I feel better already.
You are looking a little worse.
That is because I am hungry.
Oh, how thoughtless of me. I should have remembered that when one is going to lead an entirely new life, one requires regular and wholesome meals. Won't you come in?
Thank you. Might I have a buttonhole first? I never have any appetite unless I have a buttonhole first.
A Marechal Miel?
No, I'd sooner have a pink rose.
Why?
Because you are like a pink rose, Cousin Cecily.
I don't think it can be quite right for you to talk to me like this. Miss Prism never says such things to me.
Well then, Miss Prism is a short-sighted old lady. You're the prettiest girl I ever saw.
Miss Prism says that all good looks are a snare.
They are a snare that any sensible man would like to be caught in.
Oh, I don't think I would care to catch a sensible man. I wouldn't know what to talk to him about.
You are too much alone, dear Dr. Chasuble. You should get married. A misanthrope I can understand. A woman's rock, never.
Believe me, I do not deserve so neologistic a phrase. The precept and the principles of the primitive church were distinctly against matrimony.
That's obviously why the primitive church has not lost it till the present day. And you do not realize, dear Dr. Chasuble, that by persistently remaining single, a man converts himself into a permanent public temptation. Men should be more careful. This very celibacy leads weaker vessels astray.
But is not a man equally attractive when married?
Oh, no married man is ever attractive. Except to his wife.
not even to her.
That depends on the intellectual sympathies of the woman. Maturity can always be depended upon. Ripeness can be trusted. Young women are greed. I spoke horticulturally. My metaphor was drawn from fruits. But where is Cecily?
Perhaps she followed us to the schools.
Mr. Worthing!
Mr. Worthing?
This is indeed a surprise. We did not look for you until Monday afternoon.
I have returned sooner than expected. Dr. Chasuble, I hope you're well.
My dear Mr. Worthing, I trust this garb of woe does not betoken some terrible calamity.
My brother.
More shameful debts and extravagance.
Oh, and still leading a life of pleasure.
Dead.
Your brother Ernest, dead.
Quite dead.
What a lesson for him. I trust he will profit by it.
My dear Mr. Worthing, you have my sincere condolence. You do, however, have the consolation of knowing that you were the most generous and forgiving of brothers.
But poor Ernest, yet many flaws, but it is a sad, sad blow.
Oh, very sad indeed. Were you with him at the end?
No, he died abroad. In Paris, in fact. I received a telegram from the manager of the Grand Hotel last night.
And was the cause of death mentioned?
A severe chill, it seems.
As a man sows, so shall he reap.
Charity, dear Miss Prism. Charity! None of us are perfect. I myself am peculiarly susceptible to drafts. Will the interment take place here?
No, he seems to have expressed a desire to be buried in Paris.
In Paris? Well, I fear that hardly points to a serious state of mind at the last. I assume you would like me to make some slight allusion to this tragic domestic affliction next Sunday. My sermon on the meaning of manna in the wilderness can be adapted to almost any occasion. Joyful! Or, as in the present circumstances, distressing. I have preached it at harvest celebrations, christenings, confirmations, days of humiliation and festal days. The last time I delivered it was in the cathedral. As a charity sermon on behalf of the Society for the Prevention of Discontent amongst the upper orders. The bishop who was present was much taken by some of the analogies I drew.
Yes, that reminds me, Dr. Chasuble. I believe you mentioned christening.
Mm-hmm.
I assume you know how to christen, all right?
Oh.
I mean, of course, you are continually christening.
It is, I regret to say, one of the rector's most constant duties in this parish. I have often spoken to the poorer classes on the subject, but they don't seem to know what thrift is.
Do you have a particular infant in mind, Mr. Worthing? I mean, your brother was, I understand, unmarried.
Oh, yes.
People who live entirely for pleasure usually are.
But it is not for any child, dear doctor. No, I am very fond of children. No, I myself would like to be christened this afternoon, if you have nothing better to do.
But surely you have been christened already.
I don't remember anything about it.
Do you have any grave doubts on the subject?
I certainly intend to have, although I don't know if the thing would bother you in any way, or if you think I'm a little too old.
No, not at all. The sprinkling, or the immersion, is a perfectly canonical practice.
The immersion?
You need have no apprehensions. The sprinkling is all that is required, or indeed, I think, necessary. Our weather is so changeable. At what hour would you like the ceremony to be performed?
Oh, I might trot round at about 5 o'clock, if that would suit you.
Perfect. Perfect. Now, it so
outlying cottages on your own estate. Poor Jenkins, the carter. A most hard-working man.
Yes, well, I don't see much point in being christened alongside infants. It would be childish. 5:30, will that suit you?
Admirably. Admirably! But I will not intrude any longer into this house of sorrow. I would merely ask you not to be too much bowed down by grief. What seem to us bitter trials are often blessings in disguise.
This seems to me to be a blessing of an extremely obvious kind. Oh, Uncle Jack, oh, I am glad to see you back. Oh, but what horrid clothes you have got on. Do go and change them.
Cecily!
My child, my child.
What is the matter, Uncle Jack? You look as if you had a toothache. I have got such a surprise for you. Who do you think is in the dining room? Your brother.
Who?
Your brother Earnest. He arrived about 30 minutes ago.
Well, that is nonsense. I haven't got a brother.
Oh, don't say that. However badly he may have behaved to you in the past, he is still your brother. You couldn't be so heartless as to disown him. I'll tell him to come out, and you will shake hands with him, won't you, Uncle Jack?
These are very joyful tidings.
After we had become accustomed to his loss, his sudden return seems to me peculiarly distressing.
My brother is in the dining room. I don't know what it all means. I think it is absolutely absurd.
Good heavens!
Brother John! I have come up from town to tell you that I am terribly sorry for all the trouble I have caused you, and that I intend to lead a better life in the future.
Uncle Jack, you are not going to refuse your own brother's hand.
Oh, nothing will induce me to take his hand. I think he's coming down here disgraceful, and he knows perfectly well why.
Uncle Jack, do be nice. There is some good in everyone. Earnest has just been telling me about his poor invalid friend, Mr. Bunbury, who he goes to visit so often. And surely there is much good in one who is kind to an invalid and leaves the pleasures of London to sit by a bed of pain.
He's been talking about Bunbury, has he?
Oh, yes, he's told me all about poor Mr. Bunbury and his terrible state of health.
Bunbury! Well, I won't have him talk to you about Bunbury or about anything else. It's enough to drive one perfectly frantic.
Well, of course I admit that the faults were on my side, but I must say I find Brother John's coldness towards me peculiarly painful. I expected a more enthusiastic welcome, especially considering it is the first time I have come here.
Uncle Jack, if you don't shake hands with Ernest, I will never forgive you.
Never forgive me?
Never, never, never.
Well, this is the last time I shall ever do it.
It is pleasant to see so wonderful a reconciliation. I think we might safely leave the brothers together.
Cecily, you will come with us.
Certainly, Miss Prism. My little task of reconciliation is over.
You have done a wonderful action today, my child.
We must not be premature in our judgments.
I feel very happy.
For heaven's sake, Algy! You must get out of this place as soon as possible! I don't allow Bunbury of any kind here!
I have put Mr. Ernest's things in the room next to yours, sir. I hope that's all right.
What?
His luggage, sir. I have unpacked it and I've put it in the room next to your own.
His luggage?
Yes, sir. 3 portmanteaus. A dressing case, 2 hat boxes, and a large luncheon box.
I'm afraid I can't stay more than a week at this time.
Merriman, order the dog cars at once. Mr. Earnest has been suddenly called back into town.
Yes, sir.
What a fearful liar you are, Jack. I haven't been called back to town at all.
Yes, you have.
I haven't heard anyone call me.
Your duty as a gentleman calls you back.
My duty as a gentleman has never interfered in my pleasures in the smallest degree.
Oh, well, I can quite understand that.
Well, Cecily is a darling.
You are not to talk of Miss Cardew like that. I don't like it.
Well, I don't like your clothes. You look perfectly ridiculous in them. Why on earth don't you go up and change? It is perfectly childish to be in deep mourning for a man who is currently staying with you for a whole week as your guest. I call it grotesque.
You are certainly not staying with me as a guest or anything else. You've got to leave. By the 4:05 train.
I certainly won't leave you so long as you are in mourning. I would think it very unfriendly if I did. Or you would stay with me, I suppose, if I was in mourning. I would think it very unkind if you didn't.
But will you go if I change my clothes?
Yes, if you're not too long about it. I never saw anyone take so long to dress. And with such little result.
Well, at any rate, that is better than being always overdressed as you are.
If I am occasionally a little overdressed, I always make up for it by being immensely overeducated.
Oh, your vanity is ridiculous, your conduct an outrage, and your presence in my garden utterly absurd. However, you've got to catch the 4:05 train, and I hope you have a pleasant journey back. This bunburying, as you call it, it has not been a great success for you.
Well, I think it has been a great success. I'm in love with Cecily, and that is everything. But I must see her before I go. Make arrangements for another bunbury. There she is.
Oh, I nearly came back to water the roses. I thought you were with Uncle Jack.
He's gone to water the dog cart for me.
Oh, is he going to take you on a nice drive?
He's going to send me away.
Then we have got to part.
I'm afraid so. It is a very painful parting.
It is always painful to part from people whom one has known for a very brief space of time. The absence of old friends one can endure with equanimity, but even a momentary separation from anyone to whom one has just been introduced is almost unbearable.
Thank you.
The dog cart is at the door, sir.
It can wait, Merriman, for 5 minutes.
Yes.
Cecily, I hope I won't offend you if I state quite openly and frankly that you seem to me to be in every way the absolute perfection.
I think your frankness does you great credit, Earnest. If you allow me, I will copy your remarks into my diary.
Do you really keep a diary? Oh, I'd give anything to read it, may I?
No. You see, it is simply a very young girl's record of her own thoughts and impressions, and consequently meant for publication. When it appears in volume form, I hope you will order a copy. But pray, Earnest, don't stop. I delight in taking down from dictation. I have reached absolute perfection. You can go on. I am quite ready for more. Oh, don't cough, Earnest. When one is dictating, one should speak fluently and not cough. Besides, I don't know how to spell cough.
Cecily, you seem to me to be, in every way, the absolute visible personification of absolute perfection. I have dared to love you wildly, passionately, devotedly, hopelessly.
Don't think you should tell me that you love me wildly, passionately, devotedly, hopelessly. Hopelessly doesn't seem to make much sense, does it?
Oh, Cecily.
The dog cart is waiting, sir.
Then tell it to come around next week at the same hour, then.
Yes.
Uncle Jack would be very much annoyed if he knew you were staying on till next week at the same hour.
Oh, I don't care about Jack. I don't care about anything in the world besides you. I love you, Cecily. You will marry me, won't you?
Oh, you silly boy. And of course I will. Why, we have been engaged for the last 3 months.
For the last 3 months?
Yes, it will be exactly 3 months on Thursday.
But how did we become engaged?
Well, ever since dear Uncle Jack first confessed to us that he had a younger brother who was very wicked and bad, who of course have formed the chief topic of conversation between myself and Miss Prism. And of course, any man who is much talked about is always very attractive. One feels there must be something in him. Well, I dare say it was foolish of me, but I fell in love with you, Earnest.
Oh, darling. And when is the engagement actually settled?
The 14th of February last.
Oh.
worn out by your entire ignorance of my existence. I determined to end the matter one way or the other. And after a long struggle with myself, I accepted you under this dear old tree here. The next day I bought this little ring in your name, and here is the bangle with the true lover's knot that I promised you always to wear.
Did I give you this? It's very pretty, isn't it?
Oh yes, you've got wonderfully good taste, Earnest. It's the excuse I've always given you for you leading such a bad life. And I must show you, here is the box in which I keep all your dear letters.
My letters? But my dear child, I haven't written you any letters.
You need hardly remind me of that, Earnest. I remember only too well that I was forced to write them for you. Oh. You write only 3 times a week, and sometimes oftener.
Oh, well, do let me read them, Cecily.
No, they would make you far too conceited. The 3 you wrote me after I broke off the engagement are so beautiful and so badly spelled that even now I can't read them without crying a little.
But was our engagement ever broken off?
Of course it was. On the 22nd of last March. You can read the entry if you like. Today I broke off my engagement with Earnest. I feel it is better to do so. The weather still continues charming.
But why on earth did you break it off? Cecily, what had I done? I had done nothing. Oh, Cecily, I am very much hurt indeed to hear that you broke it off. Especially when the weather was so charming.
It would hardly have been a really serious engagement if it hadn't been broken off at least once. But I forgave you before the week was out.
What a perfect angel you are, Cecily.
You dear romantic boy. I hope your hair curls naturally, does it?
Yes, darling. With a little help from others.
But I am so glad.
You'll never break off our engagement again, will you, Cecily?
I don't think I could break it off now that I've actually met you. And besides, of course, there is the question of your name.
Yes, of course!
You must not laugh at me, darling, but it had always been a girlish dream of mine to love someone whose name was Earnest.
Oh.
There is something in that name that seems to inspire absolute confidence. Well, I pity any poor married woman whose husband is not called Earnest.
But my dear Cecily, do you really mean to say you couldn't love me if I had some other name?
What other name?
Oh, any name you like. Algernon, for instance.
But I don't like the name Algernon.
Oh. Well, it isn't a bad name. I can't really see why you would object to it. In fact, it is a very aristocratic name. Half the chaps in the bankruptcy courts are called Algernon. Besides, Cecily, if my name was Algie, couldn't you love me?
I might respect you, Earnest. I might even admire your character. But I feel I should not be able to give you my undivided attention.
Right. Cecily, your rector here is, I suppose, fully experienced in all the rites and ceremonials of the church?
Oh yes, Dr. Chasuble is a most learned man. He has never written a single book, so you can imagine how much he knows.
I must see him at once on the most important christening. I mean the most important business.
Oh?
I shan't be away more than half an hour.
Considering that we have been engaged since the 14th of February last, and that we only just met for the first time today, I think it is rather hard that you should leave me for such a long period as half an hour. Couldn't you make it 20 minutes?
I'll be back as soon as I can.
What an impetuous boy he is. I like his hair very much. I must enter his proposal into my diary.
Miss Fairfax has called to see Mr. Worthing on very important business, he says.
Isn't Mr. Worthing in his library?
Yes, I mentioned that, but he's gone in the direction of the rectory.
Pray ask the lady to come here. Mr. Worthing is sure to be back soon. And you can bring tea.
Yes, miss.
Miss Fairfax. women associated with some of Uncle Jack's philanthropic work in London. I don't quite like women who are associated with philanthropic work. I think it is so forward of them. Ah, pray, let me introduce myself to you. My name is Cecily Cardew.
Cecily Cardew, what a very sweet name. Something tells me we're going to be great friends. I like you already more than I can say. My first impressions of people are never wrong.
How nice of you to like me so much, after we have known each other such a comparatively short amount of time. Pray, sit down.
I may call you Cecily, may I not?
With pleasure.
And you will call me Gwendolen, won't you?
If you wish.
Then that is all quite settled. Is it not?
I hope so.
Perhaps this is a favourable opportunity for my mentioning who I am. My father's Lord Bracknell. You have never heard of Papa, I suppose?
I don't think so.
Outside the family circle, Papa, I am glad to say, is entirely unknown. I think that is as it should be. The home seems to me to be the proper sphere for the man. And certainly, once a man begins to neglect his domestic duties, he becomes painfully effeminate, does he not? And I don't like that. It makes men so painfully attractive. Cecily, Mamma's, whose views on education are remarkably strict, has brought me up to be extremely short-sighted. It is part of her system. So, do you mind my looking at you through my glasses?
Oh, not at all, Gwendolen. I am very fond of being looked at.
You were here on a short visit, I suppose?
Oh no, I live here.
Really? Your mother no doubt has some female relative of advanced years besides her also?
Oh no, I have no mother, nor in fact any relations.
Indeed.
My guardian, with the assistance of Miss Prism, has the arduous task of looking after me.
Your guardian?
Yes, I am Mr. Worthing's ward.
Oh, it's strange. He never mentioned to me before that he had a ward. How secretive of him. He grows more interesting hourly. I am not sure, however, that the news inspires me with mixed feelings of delight. I'm very fond of you, Cecily. I have liked you ever since I met you. But I am bound to state that now that I know you are Mr. Worthing's ward, I cannot help expressing a feeling... wishing I was a little older than you seem to be, and not so quite alluring in appearance. If I may speak candidly...
Oh, pray do. I think that whenever one has anything unpleasant to say, one should always be quite candid.
Oh, to speak with perfect candor, Cecily, I wish that you were fully 42, and more than usually plain for your age. Earnest has a strong, upright nature. He is the very soul of truth and honour. Disloyalty to him would be as impossible as deception. But even men of the noblest possible moral character are susceptible to the physical charms of others. Modern, no less than ancient history, supplies me with many painful examples of what I refer to. If it were not so, history would be quite unreadable.
I beg your pardon, Gwendolen. Did you say Earnest?
Yes.
Oh, but it is not Mr. Earnest Worthing who is my guardian. It is his brother, his elder brother.
Earnest never mentioned to me before that he had a brother.
I am sorry to say they have not been on good terms for a long time.
That accounts for it. Now that I think of it, I have never heard any man mention his brother. The subject seems almost distasteful amongst men. You have lifted a load from my mind, Cecily. I was growing almost anxious. It would have been a shame if any cloud had come across a friendship like ours, would it not? But you are quite sure it is not Mr. Earnest Worthing who is your guardian?
Quite sure. In fact, I am going to be his.
I beg your pardon?
Dearest Gwendolen, there is no reason I should make it a secret to you. Our little county newspaper is sure to chronicle the fact next week. Mr. Earnest Worthing and I are engaged to be married.
Dear Cecily, I feel there must be some slight error. Oh, I am engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing. The announcement will appear in the morning post on Saturday at the latest.
I am afraid you must be under some misconception. discussion. For Earnest proposed to me exactly 10 minutes ago.
It is certainly very curious. He asked me to be his wife yesterday afternoon at 5:30. If you care to verify the incident, pray do. I never trouble about my diary. One should always have something sensational to read on a train. I'm so sorry, dear Cecily, if it is of some slight disappointment to you, but it appears that I have the prior claim.
It would distress me more than I can tell you, dearest Gwendolen, if it were to cause you any mental or physical anguish. But I feel bound to point out that since Ernest proposed to you, he has clearly changed his mind.
If the poor fellow has been entrapped into a foolish promise, I shall consider it my duty to rescue him at once, and with a firm hand.
Whatever unfortunate entanglement my dear boy may have got into, I will never approach him with it after we are married.
Do I allude to you, Miss Cardew, as an entanglement? You are presumptuous. On an occasion like this, it becomes more than one's moral duty to speak one's mind. It becomes a pleasure.
Do you suggest, Miss Fairfax, that I entrapped Earnest into an engagement? How dare you? This is no time to be wearing the shallow mask of manners. When I see a spade, I call it a spade.
Well, I am glad to say that I have never seen a spade. It is obvious that our social spheres are widely different.
Miss Fairfax! Oh.
Shall I leave the tea trolley here, Miss, as usual?
Yes, as usual.
Are there many interesting walks in the vicinity, Miss Cardew?
Oh yes, a great many. From the top of one of the hills, quite close, one can see five counties.
Five counties? I don't think I should like that. I hate crowds.
I suppose that is why you live in town.
A very well-kept garden this is, Miss Cardew. I'm
so glad you like it, Miss Fairfax.
I never knew flowers grew in the country.
No, flowers are as common here, Miss Fairfax, as people are in London.
Well, personally, I cannot understand how anybody manages to exist in the country. If anybody who is anybody does, the country always bores me to death.
Ah, this is what the newspapers are calling agricultural depression, is it not? I believe the aristocracy is suffering very much from it just at present. It is almost an epidemic amongst them, I have been told. May I offer you some tea, Miss Fairfax?
Thank you. Detestable girl, but I require tea.
Sugar?
No, thank you. Sugar's not fashionable anymore.
Cake or bread and butter?
Bread and butter, please. Cake is rarely seen in the best houses nowadays.
Ernest, my own Ernest.
Gwendolen, darling.
A moment, please. May I engaged to be married to this young lady?
To dear little Cecily? Well, of course not. What could have put such an idea in your pretty little head?
Thank you. You may.
I knew there must be some misunderstanding, for the gentleman whose arm is at present round your waist is my guardian, Mr. John Worthing.
I beg your pardon.
This is Uncle Jack. Jack! Here is Earnest.
My own love.
A moment, Earnest. I'm engaged to be married to this young lady.
To which young lady? Good heavens! Gwendolen!
Yes, to good heavens, Gwendolen. I mean to Gwendolen.
Of course not. What could have put such an idea in your pretty little head?
Thank you. You may.
I felt there must be some slight error, Miss Cardew. The gentleman who is currently embracing you is my cousin, Mr. Algernon Moncrieff.
Algernon Moncrieff? Are you called Algernon?
I cannot deny it.
Is your name really John?
I could deny it if I liked. I could deny anything if I liked, but my name is in fact John. It has been John for many years.
A gross deception has been practiced on us both.
My poor wounded Cecily.
My sweet, wronged Gwendolen.
I may call you sister, may I not?
There is just one question I would like to be allowed to ask my guardian.
Enough, my dear. Mr. Worthing, there is just one question I would like to be permitted to put to you. Where is your brother Earnest? We are both engaged to be married to your brother Earnest, so it is of some great importance to us that we know where he is at present.
Gwendolen, Cecily, it is very painful for me to be forced to speak the truth. It is the first time in my life I've ever been reduced to such a painful position. And I must say I'm quite inexperienced in doing anything of the kind. However, I will tell you quite frankly that I have no brother, Earnest. I have no brother at all. I've never had a brother in my life, and I certainly have not the smallest intention of ever having one in the future.
No brother at all?
None.
Have you never had a brother of any kind?
Never, not even of any kind.
It is quite clear, Cecily, that neither of us are engaged to be married to anyone.
Not a very pleasant position for a young girl to find herself in, is it?
Let us go into the house. They are hardly likely to venture after us there.
No, men are so cowardly, aren't they?
Cecily,
this ghastly state of things is what you call bunburying, is it?
Yes, and a perfectly wonderful bunbury it is too. The most wonderful bunbury I've ever had in my life.
Well, you've no right whatsoever to bunbury here.
Oh, that is absurd. One has a right to bunbury anywhere one chooses. Every serious bunburyist knows that.
Serious bunburyist? Oh, good heavens!
Well, one must be serious about some things if one wants to have any amusement in life. I happen to be serious about bunbury. What on earth you're serious about, I haven't the remotest idea. About everything, I should imagine. Such a trivial nature you have.
Well, the only small satisfaction I can take away from the whole of this wretched business is that your friend Bunbury is quite exploded. You won't be able to run up to the country quite so often as you used to, and a very good thing too.
Your brother is looking a little off colour, isn't he, dear Jack? You won't be able to disappear off to London quite so frequently as your wicked custom was, and not a bad thing either.
As for your conduct towards Miss Cardew, I must say that your taking in a sweet, simple, innocent girl like that is quite inexcusable, to say nothing of the fact that she is my ward.
Oh, and I can see no possible defence for your deceiving a brilliant, clever, thoroughly experienced lady like Miss Fairfax, to say nothing of the fact that she is my cousin.
I wanted to be engaged to Gwendolen, that is all. I love her.
Well, I simply wanted to be engaged to Cecily. I adore her.
There is certainly no chance of you and Miss Cardew being married.
And I don't think there is much likelihood, Jack, of you and Miss Fairfax being united.
Well, that is no business of yours.
Ha! If it was my business, I wouldn't talk about it. It's very vulgar to talk about one's business. Only people like stockbrokers do that, and then merely at dinner parties.
How can you sit there calmly eating muffins like that? I can't make out. You seem to me to be perfectly heartless.
Well, I can't eat
muffins in an agitated manner, the butter would probably get on my cuffs. No, one should always eat muffins quite calmly. It's the only way to eat them.
I say it's perfectly heartless you eating them at all, especially under the circumstances.
When I am in trouble, eating is the only thing that consoles me. Indeed, when I am in really great trouble, as anyone who knows me intimately will tell you, I refuse everything except food and drink. At the present moment, I am eating because I am unhappy. Besides, I am particularly fond of muffins.
Well, that is no reason to eat them all in that greedy manner.
I wish you would have a tea cake instead. I don't like tea cake.
Good heavens! I suppose a man may eat his own muffins in his own garden.
But you just said it was perfectly heartless to eat muffins.
I said it was perfectly heartless of you under the circumstances.
Well, that may be, but the muffins are the same.
Algie, I wish to goodness you would go.
You can't possibly ask me to go without having my dinner first. I never go without my dinner. Nobody ever does. Well, except vegetarians and people like that. Besides, I have just made arrangements with Dr. Chasuble to be christened at 6:15 under the name of Earnest.
My dear fellow, the sooner you give up that nonsense, the better. I myself have also made arrangements with Dr. Chasuble to be christened at 5:30, and I naturally will take the name of Earnest. Gwendolen would wish it. And we can't both be christened Earnest. It's absurd. Besides, I have a perfect right to be christened if I like. I don't think there's any evidence to suggest that I have ever been christened, and neither does Dr. Chasuble. But it is entirely different in your case. You have already been christened.
Yes, but I've not been christened for years.
Yes, but you have been christened, and that is the important thing.
Quite so. So I know that my constitution can stand it. But if you're not even sure about having ever been christened, I must say I think it rather dangerous you're venturing on it now. It might make you very unwell, and you can hardly have forgotten that someone very closely connected with you was very nearly carried off in Paris this week by a severe chill.
Yes, you said so yourself. A severe chill is not hereditary.
Oh, it used to be, I know. But I dare say it is now. Science is always making wonderful discoveries and things.
Oh, that is nonsense, Algernon. Mm. You never talk anything but nonsense.
Jack, you're at the muffins again. I wish you wouldn't. I told you I was particularly fond of muffins, and there are only two left.
But I hate tea cake.
What on earth? Would you allow tea cake to be served up to your guests? What ideas you have of hospitality!
Algernon, I've already told you to go. I don't want you here. Why don't you go?
I haven't quite finished my tea yet. And there's still one muffin left.
Mr. Worthing, what explanation can you offer to me for pretending to have a brother?
Was it in order that you may have the opportunity of coming to town to see me as often as possible?
Can you doubt it, Miss Fairfax?
I have the gravest doubts upon the subject, but I intend to crush them. This is no time for general skepticism. The explanations seem to be quite satisfactory, especially Mr. Worthing's, which seems to have a stamp of truth upon it.
I am more than content with what Mr. Moncrieff said. His voice alone inspires one with absolute credulity.
Then you think we should forgive them?
Yes. I mean, no.
True. I had forgotten. There are principles at stake and one cannot surrender. Which one of us should tell them? The task is not a pleasant one.
Could we not both speak at the same time?
An excellent idea. I nearly always speak at the same time as other people. You would take the time from me?
Certainly.
Your Christian names are still an insuperable barrier. That is all.
Our Christian names? Is that all? But we're going to be christened this afternoon.
For me, you are prepared to do this terrible thing.
I am.
To please me, you are ready to face this fearful ordeal.
I am.
How absurd to talk of the equality of sexes. When self-sacrifice is concerned, men are infinitely beyond us.
We are.
They have moments of physical courage of which we women know absolutely nothing.
Darling.
Darling.
Lady Bracknell.
Good heavens.
Gwendolen, what does this mean?
Meaning that I am engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing, Mama.
Come here. Sit down. Sit down immediately. Hesitation of any kind is a sign of mental decay in the young, of physical weakness in the old. Apprised, sir, of my daughter's sudden flight by her trusty maid, whose confidence I purchased by means of a small coin, I followed her at once by a luggage train. Her unhappy father is, I am pleased to say, under the impression that she is attending a more than usually lengthy lecture by the University Extension Scheme on the positive influence of a permanent income on thought. I do not propose to undeceive him. In fact, I have never undeceived him on any question. I would consider it wrong. But you must understand from me that all communication between yourself and my daughter must cease immediately from this moment. On this point, as indeed on all points, I am firm.
No, I am engaged to be married to Gwendolen, Lady Bracknell.
You are nothing of the kind, sir. And now as regards to Algernon. Algernon?
Yes, son, Professor.
Is it in this house that your invalid friend, Mr. Bunbury, resides?
Oh, no, Bunbury doesn't live here. No, Bunbury is somewhere else at present. In fact, Bunbury is... Bunbury's dead.
Dead? When did Mr. Bunbury die? His death must have been extremely sudden.
I killed him this afternoon. I mean, he died this afternoon!
What did he die of?
Bunbury? He was... quite exploded!
Exploded? Was he the victim of a revolutionary outrage? I was not aware that Mr. Bunbury was interested in social legislation. If so, he is well punished for his morbidity.
My dear Aunt Augusta, what I mean is, he was found out. Yes, you see, the doctors found out that Bunbury simply could not live anymore. And so, Bunbury died.
He seems to have had great confidence in the opinion of his physician. I am glad, however, that at the end he made up his mind to some definite course of action and acted under proper medical advice. And now that we have finally got rid of this Mr. Bunbury, Mr. Worthing, may I ask who is that young person whose hand my nephew Algernon is holding in what appears to me a particularly unnecessary manner?
This is Miss Cecily Cardew, my ward.
I'm engaged to be married to Cecily, Aunt Augusta.
I beg your pardon?
Mr. Moncrieff and I are engaged to be married, Lady Bracknell.
I do not know whether there's anything peculiarly exciting in the air in this particular part of Hertfordshire, but the number of engagements that go on seem to me considerably above the average that statistics have laid down for our guidance. I think some preliminary inquiry on my part would not be out of the question. Mr. Worthing, is Miss Cardew at all connected with any of the larger railway stations in London? I merely require information. Until yesterday, I had no idea of any family or persons whose origin was a terminus.
Miss Cardew is the granddaughter of the late Mr. Thomas Cardew of 149 Belgrave Square, Southwest, Gervais Park, Dorking, Surrey, and the Sporran, Fifeshire, North Berwick.
That sounds not unsatisfactory. Three addresses always inspire confidence, even in tradesmen. But what proof have I of their authenticity?
Well, I have carefully preserved the court guides of the period. They are open to your inspection, Lady Bracknell.
I have known strange and curious errors in that publication.
Well, Miss Cardew's family solicitors are Messrs. Markby, Markby, and Markby.
Markby, Markby, and Markby. A firm of the very highest position in their profession. Indeed, I am told that one of the Mr. Markbys is occasionally to be seen at dinner parties. So far, I am satisfied.
Well, how extremely kind of you, Lady Bracknell. I also have in my possession, you will be pleased to hear, certificates of Miss Cardew's birth, baptism, whooping cough, registration, vaccination, confirmation, and the measles! Both the German and the English variety.
Ah! A life crowded with incident, I see. Though perhaps somewhat too exciting for a young person. I myself am not in favour of premature experiences. Gwendolen, time approaches for our departure. We have not a moment to lose. But before I go, as a matter of form, Mr. Worthing, may I inquire if Miss Cardew has any small fortune?
Oh, about £130,000 in the funds, and that is all. Goodbye, Lady Bracknell, so pleased to have seen
you. A moment, Mr. Worthing, a moment. £130,000, and in the funds. Miss Cardew seems the most attractive young lady. Now that I look at her, few girls of the present day have any really solid qualities, any of the qualities that last and improve with age. We live, I regret to say, in an age of surfaces. Now come over here, dear. Your dress is sadly simple, and your hair seems almost as nature might have left it. But we can soon alter all that. A really experienced French maid produces a marvellous effect in a very short space of time. I remember recommending one to young Lady Lansing, and after 3 months, her own husband did not know her.
And after 6 months, nobody knew her.
Come over here, dear. Turn around. No, 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 the side profile is what I want. Yes, yes. Yes, just as I thought. There are distinct social possibilities in your profile. The two weak points of our age are its want of principle and its want of profile. Chin a little higher, dear. Style largely depends on the way the chin is worn. They are worn very high just at present. Algernon?
Yes, Aunt Augusta?
There are distinct social possibilities in Miss Cardew's profile.
Oh, Cecily is the sweetest, dearest, prettiest girl in the whole world. And I don't give tuppence about social possibilities.
Never speak disrespectfully of society, Algernon. Only people who cannot get into it do that. Of course you know, dear child, Algernon has nothing but his debts to recommend him. But I do not approve of mercenary managers. When I married Lord Bracknell, I had no fortune of my own. But I never dreamt for a moment of allowing that to stand in my way. Well, I suppose I must give my consent.
Oh, thank you, Aunt Augusta.
Cecily, you may kiss me.
Thank you, Lady Bracknell.
And you may call me Aunt Augusta for the future.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
I think the marriage had better take place quite soon.
Oh, thank you, Aunt Augusta.
Well,
thank you, Aunt Augusta.
Well, to speak quite frankly, I am not in favour of long engagements. They give people the opportunity of finding out each other's faults before marriage, which I never think is advisable.
Pardon me for interrupting you, Lady Bracknell, but I'm afraid this engagement is quite out of the question. I am Miss Cardew's guardian, and she cannot marry without my consent until she comes of age. That consent I absolutely decline to give.
Upon what grounds, may I ask? Algernon is an extremely, I may almost say ostentatiously eligible young man. He has nothing but looks everything. What more could one desire?
It pains me very much to have to speak frankly to you, Lady Bracknell, about your nephew. But the fact is, I do not approve at all of his moral character. I suspect him of being untruthful.
Untruthful? My nephew Algernon? Impossible. He went to Oxford.
I fear there can be no possible doubt about the matter. I mean, this afternoon, during my temporary absence in London, on an important question of romance, he obtained admission to my house by means of the false pretense of being my brother.
No.
Under an assumed name, he drank, I've just been informed by my butler, an entire pint bottle of my Perrier Jouet Brut 89, wine I was specially reserving for myself. Continuing his disgraceful deception, he succeeded in the course of the afternoon in alienating the affections of my only ward. He subsequently staked a tea and devoured every single muffin. And what makes his conduct all the more heartless is that he was perfectly well aware from the first that I have no brother, that I've never had a brother in my life, and that I don't intend to have a brother, not even of any kind. I specifically told him so myself yesterday afternoon.
Mr. Worthing, I have decided entirely to overlook my nephew Algernon's conduct towards you.
How very generous of you, Lady Bracknell. However, my own decision is unalterable. I decline to give my consent.
Come over here, dear. How old are you?
Well, I am only really 18, but I always admit to 20 at evening parties.
You are quite right to make some slight adjustment. No woman should ever be entirely accurate about her age. It looks so calculating. 18, but admitting to 20 at evening parties. Well, it will not be long before you are of age and free from the restraints of tutelage. So I do not think that your guardian's consent will, after all, be a matter of any importance.
Pray excuse me, Lady Bracknell, for interrupting you again. But I feel it is only fair to tell you that, according to the terms of her grandfather's will, Miss Cardew does not legally come of age until she is 35.
That does not seem to be a grave objection. 35 is a very attractive age. London society is full of women of the highest birth who, by their own free choice, have remained 35 for years. Lady Dumbleton is a case in point. To my very own knowledge, she has remained 35 ever since she arrived at the age of 40, which was many years ago now. I see no reason why our dear Cecily will not be even more attractive at the age you mentioned than the one that she is now. There will be a large accumulation of property.
Algy, could you wait for me until I was 35?
Of course I could, Cecily. You know I could.
Yes, I felt it instinctively. But I'm afraid I could not wait all that time. I hate waiting even 5 minutes for anybody. It always makes me rather cross. I am not punctual myself, I know, but I do like punctuality in others. And waiting, even to be married, is quite out of the question.
But then, what is to be done, Cecily?
I don't know, Mr. Moncrieff.
My dear Mr. Worthing, as Miss Cardew states positively that she cannot possibly wait until she is 35, a remark that I am bound to say seems to show a somewhat impatient nature. I beg you to reconsider your decision.
But, my dear Lady Bracknell, the matter is entirely in your own hands. The moment you consent to my marriage with Gwendolen, I will gladly allow your nephew to form an alliance with my ward.
You must understand that what you are asking is completely out of the question.
Then a passionate celibacy is all that any of us can look forward to.
That is not the destiny I propose for Gwendolen. Algernon is free to choose for himself. Come, dear. We have missed 5, if not 6 trains. To miss any more might expose us to comment on the platform.
Everything is ready for the christenings.
The christening, sir? Is that not somewhat premature?
Well, both these gentlemen have expressed a desire for immediate baptism.
At their age, the idea is grotesque and irreligious. Elginor, I forbid you to be baptized. I will not hear of such excesses. Your uncle, Lord Bracknell, would be most upset if he was to learn that that was the way in which you wasted your time and money.
Am I to understand, then, there are to be no christenings this afternoon?
I feel, as things are now, it wouldn't be of much practical value to either of us, Dr. Chasuble.
Oh, I am grieved to hear such sentiments from you, Mr. Worthing. They savour of the heretical views of the Anabaptists. Views that I have completely refuted in 4 of my unpublished sermons. However, as your mood seems to be peculiarly secular, I shall return to the church at once. I have just been informed by the pew opener that for the last hour and a half, Miss Prism has been waiting for me in the vestry.
Miss Prism? Did I hear you say Miss Prism?
Yes, Lady Bracknell, I'm going to join her.
Pray allow me to detain you a moment longer. This is a matter which may prove of vital importance to Lord Bracknell and myself. Is this Miss Prism a female of repellent aspect, remotely connected with education?
She is the most respectable of ladies.
It is obviously the same person. May I inquire what position she holds in your household?
I am Sir Celibate, madam!
Miss Prism, Lady Bracknell, has been for the last 3 years Miss Cardew's esteemed governess and valued companion.
In spite of what you tell me, I must see her at once. Let her be sent for.
She is coming. She is nigh.
I was told that you expected me in the vestry, dear Canon. I have been waiting there for an hour and 3 quarters.
Prism? Come here, Prism. Prism? Where is that baby? Oh. 28 years ago, Prism, you left Lord Bracknell's house 104 Upper Grosvenor Street in charge of a perambulator that contained a baby of the male sex. You never returned. Several weeks later, through the elaborate investigations of the Metropolitan Police, the perambulator was discovered, abandoned, in a remote corner of Bayswater. It contained a manuscript of a 3-volume novel of more than usually revolting sentimentality. But the baby was not there. Prism, where is that baby?
Lady Bracknell, I admit with shame that I do not know. Oh. The plain facts of the case are these. On the morning of the day that you mention, a day that is forever branded in my memory, I prepared as usual to take the baby out in its perambulator. I had also with me a somewhat old but capacious handbag, in which I had intended to place the manuscript of a work of fiction which I had completed in my few unoccupied hours. But in a moment of mental abstraction, for which I never can forgive myself, I deposited the manuscript in the bassinet, and I placed the baby in the handbag.
But where did you deposit the handbag?
Oh, do not ask me, Mr. Worthing.
Miss Prism, this is a matter of no small importance to me. I insist on knowing where you placed the handbag that contained that infant.
Oh, I left it in the cloakroom of one of the larger railway stations in London.
Which railway station?
Oh,
I must retire to my room for a moment. Gwendolen, wait here for me.
If you are not too long, I shall wait here for you all my life.
What do you think this means, Lady Bracknell?
I dare hardly imagine, Dr. Chasuble. I need hardly tell you that in families of high birth, strange coincidences are not supposed to occur. They are not considered the thing.
Uncle Jack seems strangely agitated.
Your guardian has a particularly emotional character.
It sounds as if he's having an argument of some kind. I dislike arguments of any kind. They are always vulgar and often convincing.
It is stopped, darling.
I do wish he would come to some conclusion.
The suspense is terrible. I hope it will last.
Is this the handbag, Miss Prism? Examine it carefully before you speak. The happiness of more than one life depends on your answer.
It seems to be mine. Oh, here is the injury it received on the upsetting of a Gower Street omnibus in younger and happier days. Oh, yes, and here is the stain on the lining caused by the explosion of a temperance beverage, an incident that occurred in Leamington. But here on the lock are my initials. I had forgotten that in an extravagant mood I had had them placed there. The bag is undoubtedly mine. Oh, I am so pleased to have it restored to me. After all this time, it has been a great inconvenience being without it.
More is restored to you than the handbag, Miss Prism. I was the infant you placed in it.
You?
Yes. Mother!
Oh, Mr. Worthing! I am unmarried!
Not unmarried! I cannot deny that is a serious blow. But who has a right to cast a stone against one who has suffered? Cannot repentance wipe out an act of folly? Why must there be one law for men and another for women? Mother, I forgive you!
No, Mr. Worthing! There is some error! There is the lady who can tell you who you really are.
Lady Bracknell? I hate to seem inquisitive. But would you kindly inform me who I am?
I am afraid the information I have to give you will not entirely... It may upset you a little. You are the son of my poor sister, Mrs. Moncrieff, and consequently Algernon's elder brother.
Algy's elder brother? Then I have a brother after all. I knew I had a brother. I always said I had a brother. Cecily, how would you have ever doubted that I had a brother? Dr. Chasuble, my unfortunate brother. Miss Prism, my unfortunate brother. Gwendolen, my unfortunate brother. Algy, a young scoundrel. You'll have to treat me with more respect in the future. You've never behaved like a brother to me in all your life.
Well, not until today, old boy, I admit. Though I was out of practice. Well, I did give it my best, however.
My own one, but what own are you now that you've become someone else?
Oh, good heavens. I had quite forgotten the fact. Your decision on the subject of my name remains irrevocable, I suppose.
I never change, except in my affections. What a noble nature you have, Gwendolen.
And the question had better be cleared up at once. Aunt Augusta, a moment. After Miss Prism placed me in the handbag, had I been christened by that time?
Oh, every luxury that money could buy, including christening, had been lavished on you by your fond and doting parents.
Then I was christened, that is settled. But what name was I given? Well, let me know the worst.
Well, being the eldest child, you were naturally called after your father.
Well, yes, but what was my father's Christian name?
I cannot recall at the present moment what the general's name was. I have no doubt he had one. He was eccentric, but that was in later years. And that was as a result of the Indian climate and marriage and indigestion and things of that sort.
Algy, Can't you recollect what our father's Christian name was?
Oh, my dear boy, we were never even on speaking terms. He died before I was a year old.
His name would appear in the army lists of the period, I suppose, Aunt Augusta.
Yes, yes, the general was essentially a man of peace, except in his domestic life. But I have no doubt his name would appear in any military directory.
The army lists of the last 40 years, they're here. These delightful records. They should have been my constant study. Generals. Malum, Maximum, Magley. What ghastly names they have. Markby, Mixby, Mobbs, Moncrieff. Lieutenant, 1840. Captain, Lieutenant Colonel, Colonel. General, 1869. Christian names? Earnest John. I always told you my name was Earnest, didn't I, Gwendolen? Well, it is Earnest after all. I mean, naturally, it is Earnest.
Yes, the general was called Earnest, now I remember. I knew I had a particular reason for disliking that name.
Earnest, my own Earnest. I felt from first you could have no other name.
Gwendolen, it is a terrible thing for a man to discover that his whole life he's been speaking nothing but the truth. Can you forgive me?
I can. I feel sure you are bound to change.
My own one.
Letitia!
Frederick! At last!
Cecily, at last.
Gwendolen, at last.
My nephew, you seem to be displaying signs of triviality.
Well, on the contrary, Aunt Augusta, for I have finally realised for the first time in my life the vital importance of being earnest.